Here's a Christmas menu with not a sprout in sight.
Ruth Rogers and Rose Gray have brought the taste of Italian home cooking to the banks of the Thames. They've opened up their restaurant to prepare a truly alternative Christmas dinner. Oven-roasted loin of pork with seasonal pumpkin, polenta with white truffles, and a rich Van Santo ice cream. Their team will also cook a range of classic Italian dishes like spinach rotolo and whole organic pig as we spend a day in the life of the River Café.
I learned to cook through Italian home cooking. What we tried to do is we thought, why can't we get the food that we have in these Italian homes in restaurants in London or anywhere, even in the Italian restaurants? And so we took these recipes back to London and put them into what was then a very small restaurant.
Both of us, being intuitive cooks, always cooked for lots of people in our families. We both come from big families. You want to find the best way of cooking whatever the wonderful ingredient is that you happen to have got.
Beautiful fresh grass, lovely purple gills.
I think turkey is a difficult bird to cook, and in fact I haven't cooked turkeys for years for Christmas for my family. I have cooked geese and I've cooked game, but one of the marvellous things about now is that we're really getting our hands on the most incredible pork.
We've got here a huge Gloucester black spot.
Yeah.
It's 3 months old.
Yeah.
And it weighed 34 pounds.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a big breed, Gloucester black spot. They become enormous by the time, you know, they've grown to their full size. Now, Theo and I are going to score it all over the skin with small, sharp paring knives. And then we're going to rub fennel and garlic into the skin of the pig. It's really what's called porchetta in Tuscany, and you get these roadside vans. Have you ever seen those?
Yeah.
And basically, they have a sort
that's
of oven
the best
in
way.
The
that's
van.
That's the best way of eating the pork.
That is great. And you have a sandwich. You have an oven in this van, and they have these whole pigs, which they cook in the oven, bigger than this, quite a bit bigger, probably sort of 60 to 80 pound pigs. And they have it all set up in the van by the side of the road, and everybody stops and
just eats.
Goes and buys a porchetta sandwich, a panini di porchetta.
Yeah.
Everybody uses fennel seeds for flavouring in Italy. I mean, it's a traditional with marries with pork.
But look at the colour, they're really green.
Yeah, beautiful.
I mean,
yeah, lovely.
They're really much.
How much garlic did you put in there?
There's about 8 cloves in this.
Put a few more.
Yeah.
I think you need more. It's too fennel and not enough garlic. This seasoning is great for pork. I mean, it's one of the traditional Italian ways of flavouring pork loin, pork shoulder, pork leg when you're roasting it.
Perfect.
OK, let's just have a quick look at him.
What's his name?
Get him out, because I wanted to show you how we dressed him up. For Christmas.
Party hat.
We put silver foil over the ears and over the snout because we don't want to burn. That's very thin there, the thin ears, which will burn in the wood oven. And over his snout too, we don't want it to get too black. So we've dressed him up for the party.
Okay,
all right, let's
him?
Push him in. Yeah. Can you push him in? Bye, pig. Have a nice Christmas.
The wood oven adds a particular flavour, but you can roast a cut such as loin of pork with the same seasonings in your own oven.
You've got another 5 here. And these two chickens, that's what I've been trying to say. That's it. Well, good. How is it? Taste it. Are
you going to change the oil roast?
No, this is the first oil that we have just until about mid-November. This is from Sicily. I'm waiting for 3 seconds. Got a lot of pepper on the back, hasn't it, of the throat.
It's the food that is most interesting to me. It's the kind of food that is cooked with love, that is cooked with nourishment, that is cooked fresh every day, that is, you know, and I think especially in Italy, what we both know is that the markets lend itself to going and seeing what is there that day. It's not a weekly shop in a big, you know, supermarket. The ingredients are our vocabulary. People say to me, how did you get the idea of making this? It's really not about ideas. It's about building this vocabulary that you have. We all know the kind of language that we're using. So when we speak about a pepper or about a piece of fish that has come in, we'll think about the way that fish can best be. We also are balancing how much we have on the grill, how much we have on the wood oven. And the communication is such that it just evolves through this knowledge that we have.
My God, they are beautiful. Lovely crabs, male crabs.
Oh, wait.
Right, I've got a piece of beautiful organic pork. It weighs about 8 pounds, Jamie.
Yeah.
So I reckon that for a Christmas dinner for a family of 8, 9, 10, this is a perfect size piece. This is the weight on the bone. And Jamie is going to take it off the bone for me, but you can ask your butcher to do that. We are going to make this a very celebration dish of loin of pork roasted because it's Christmas. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut away the skin, leaving a little thin layer of the fat. Pork needs a little bit of fat when you're roasting it. If you take all the fat off, it could be dry. We're going to make a mixture of the herbs, the fennel seeds, the garlic, the salt and the pepper, and a little bit of rosemary. And we're going to rub it round the whole of the boned piece when it hasn't got its fat on. We're going to score this like you have for roast pork conventionally. And then we're going to replace the crackling on top of the loin when it has been seasoned and flavoured. And we're going to tie it up with string, and then we're going to rub all our herb mixture into the skin too, and then we're going to roast it. I know this seems like quite a bit of an effort, but it's really worth it for your Christmas dinner, isn't it? This little extra effort of tying it up yourself. So well done, Jamie, that's beautiful. Should we just, what we didn't do, you know, is put any of this on the top skins, and we did talk about it, so should we just rub it down like that? Not much, because I think it'll burn, because we're going to put it in an oven at 425 degrees. Now let's put it in the roasting tray. I've got one here, Jamie. Want to put it in?
Yeah.
Should put it. Oops, let's get that butter. Might as well not waste that. We may have to cover it, do you think, for a second or two, halfway through cooking?
Yeah, I think we should start it off rather quick and then get a bit of tin foil over it, maybe, to stop the crackling from colouring anymore.
Yes, exactly. Right, into the oven.
Roast the loin at 400 degrees for half an hour, then turn the oven off, open the door and leave for a further 30 minutes before you carve.
So the door has been open in this oven, which is the final part of the roasting. And that is just when the meat is cooling off. You turn the oven off and it's just relaxing lightly and it looks absolutely wonderful. We're going to get some delicious juice, Jamie, which we'll... Can I have one of those?
Yeah.
I'm going to cut it.
Okay.
So... Beautiful. Christmas in Italy is magical, and one of the things that I remember when I lived there was the tremendous excitement when the air is cold and frosty, of going to the market and buying a little white truffle. It seemed to have so much magic about it. And, I mean, if you don't have very much money, you buy a little tiny one, or you even buy one in a jar, but it's so special. White truffles are a fungus that grow underground. They are harvested between October and December, so make a great Christmas treat. At the cafe, we get them flown over from Italy, and unpacking them is always exciting.
The idea is we got the flavour and the risotto.
Is that another one?
Yeah. Another one. It's like digging ourselves, isn't it? Truffle hunting.
And this is quite a good price. You know how much they are this year? £900 a kilo.
Cheap.
They can go up to £1,200 a kilo.
Okay.
Is that
that's
it?
That's it. Yeah, but that's wrong. That's only four 500 grams.
Which isn't even weighing quite
much. Is it? That's it?
They've got this wrong.
Something wrong here.
Our truffles have just arrived, and on the invoice it says 832 grams, right? And in the box that we were handed, there were 320 grams. I still got the delivery man here. Bit of a drama. The point is that we've got the truffles, but they do not weigh what it says on the invoice. It's considerably less. I mean, it's not even half. Well, what are you going to do about this? Because I'm certainly not forking out 748 quid for what I've got here.
Truffles are very expensive and hard to get hold of. Mixed wild mushrooms make a superb alternative.
The food of Italy is completely regional, and so as you would find rice being the staple in the Veneto, or bread in Tuscany with the bread soups, polenta is a very staple grain that is used in northernmost Italy, where it's very, very cold, very mountainous. Polenta is a very comforting food, and the accompaniments can be as simple or as luxurious as you like. The polenta that I'm using here is Bermata polenta. It's made of three organic types of corn, and you can see it in the texture. You see the white, a very dark golden color, and a paler yellow color, which gives both the texture and a rather sweetish taste to it. And it's very, very easy to cook.
To feed between 6 and 8 people, you will need 350 grams of polenta and 2 liters of salt water. To avoid making it lumpy, stir quickly while you pour.
And then as soon as I've got all the grains down, I'm going to lower the heat, and then we're going to stir the polenta in. The way you know that it's done is that after about 40 minutes, 45 minutes, the polenta is thick enough so that it falls from the side of the pan, or if you hold up a spoon, it just very slowly falls from the spoon. It's now 40 minutes later, and you can see that the polenta has completely changed. And I'm going to add some salt, sea salt, and pepper, black pepper. And I'm going to also add some butter, which is very soft, Parmesan cheese, and stir that in.
Today, Jamie's cooking a rotolo, fresh pasta with spinach, ricotta and porcini.
This rotolo's been on for about 15, 20 minutes now. As you can see, it's boiling away quite smoothly. I'm going to pull it out now. I've got 3 orders on, so I've got to really move it. Drain it a bit. I've got some sage butter here, touch of pepper. I'm going to give that to Theo, and he's going to finish it with a little bit of Parmesan.
So we're going to do plenty of wild mushrooms. So, Theo, oh, you got yourself a little drink, have you?
Yeah.
Caesar. Okay, so we're going to do... I'm going to do... plenty with mushrooms and plenty with white truffles right now.
Okay. Right, so okay,
can
I'm
going to
buy
porcini.
The porcini, yeah, of course.
So what? Let's have a look at your porcini.
Okay, right.
Let's have a look at your porcini.
It's a Bellita sedulis.
Porcini in Italian. Very often you can buy dry porcini, and you could make this dish using dry porcini that you can buy in most supermarkets.
Best fresh.
But fresh ones are, you know, heaven.
Very hot pan here, let's put some butter in. I'm going to add the porcini. Wait for the butter to foam subside. Add the porcini. I'm not adding the garlic yet because I don't want the garlic to burn. I just want to get the mushrooms cooked. Now, a little bit of garlic. A little bit of thyme. Thyme, parsley, salt and pepper, and I'm just going to get a squeeze of lemon, fresh lemon, put in. Give me a lemon, please. Thank you. Just squeeze a lemon. And cut the polenta rose. Delicious. Come on, lemon. Thank you. Okay, and this is...
Beautiful.
That's it, the porcini.
Wonderful. Got that. Okay. Perfect. Right, now, Theo.
Yeah?
Can we do another one, darling?
You want another one?
With white truffles right now.
Okay.
Okay.
That's the truffle. It's a beautiful one. I'm just going to slice it on a truffle slicer. Which gives you incredibly fine slivers. And that gives a maximum aroma of the truffle.
Alright, they've got two linguine and a risotto with that, so I want to ask Bernie to help me. Bernie, can you do me a risotto, mate?
Yeah, okay.
We've got a menu that changes twice a day, and it's extremely seasonal. It can change in a matter of days and weeks, the whole what we can get hold of, you know? Bit of parsley. We got dill that we picked earlier, the sorrel, more parsley in here. And as far as I'm concerned as a chef, you know, it's the best job, because not only do we have new things to cook every day, but we actually have a hand in writing the menu as well. The risotto's there. I'm gonna put a touch of mascarpone in. So in with the parmesan. Touch of vermouth. That's just ready. Right, with the first risotto. Here we go.
Wait a minute. One spadino, one risotto. Okay?
The restaurant works on the basis that we change the menu twice daily, and so we write the menu according to what we have left, what we've ordered, and most importantly, what is in season. The menus are completely seasonal.
The bruschetta. Alright, so we've got the crab salad. We're going to take away from cheeses.
You can get vegetables flown in from every part of the world now, but we've always tried to retain the idea, which is most exciting to us, which is to cook the food in season, the food of its time.
Hi there.
Hi. I was just wondering, you have the caviloes, because
yep.
I want to put it on the menu.
Yeah, we have.
That's lovely.
It's quite great. Sort of pale green in the middle, you know. It should go darker.
Yeah, it just doesn't get as much light in the middle. Nice. There's a lot more of winter to go,
it looks
isn't
lovely.
It?
Look at those. It's beautiful.
You do a great Rivolita now.
Are you going to do Rivolita?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, of course, I supply the seeds to Ian, and he charges me £8.55.
The growing's the heartbeat, you know.
The growing's the heartbeat,
yeah.
Okay, so what else have you brought me?
Yeah, plenty of squashes again. The onion squash that you're using a lot of.
Yeah, we love these. These are beautiful. So they grow really well in your store.
All right, so the vegetables that we're going to put with our delicious pig that we've roasted, we're going to do roast pumpkin, onion pumpkin, Prince pumpkin and cricket ball pumpkin. So now I'm going to cut up this cricket ball pumpkin, which has got a rock hard skin. These are really... Okay. All right, now, these pumpkins, once they've been seasoned and put into a hottish oven, will take about 20 minutes. I'm going to give them to Talia. Okay, I just asked Talia to, in the pestle and mortar, grind up a little bit of coriander seed, a bit of fennel seed, garlic, salt and pepper, and that will be a sort of dry, sticky mix, which I'm then going to lubricate with olive oil, salt and pepper. It might seem rather messy, but chefs usually do cook with their hands rather than their spoons, so I'm going to now, more or less covering each piece of pumpkin. I don't want a lot of oil in here, because then it'll burn and go black and it'll be too oily, and I don't want that. All I want to do is just, as you can now see, lightly season and cover the pumpkin. Okay, that's ready for the oven.
Roast the pumpkin in your oven at home at 400 degrees for between 20 to 30 minutes.
From day one in the restaurant, we sort of thought of our staff that wait on the tables rather like a family thinks of one's children. And so we thought, well, what we'll do is we'll get them to prep the herbs we use, all the simple things that we prepare. And it's a way of learning. And then when they talk to their customers, you know, they can say to the customer, this is fresh oregano, this is cavolo nero, this is organic pork, this is, you know, new season's garlic, these porcini have just arrived, we know this is the first we've had this year. And you can, you know, it's a very nice thing to be able to do as a waiter, to be able to inform the customer.
Got our chanterelles, which I picked earlier. We've cleaned them up with a brush. We haven't washed them because they go too soggy otherwise. The pan's about hot now. So we're gonna get a good handful in there for one serve. In the meantime, there's a bruschetta on the grill and the bruschetta's gonna come to me. I'm gonna serve it on top of it. Right, we've got garlic here with some olive oil. I'm gonna add a little bit of that. We've got some ground chili here. They're really hot. Okay, these are nearly there now. In a minute or two, I'm gonna put a little bit of butter in it to give it a nice shine, nice flavor. And a touch of lemon juice at the last minute just to give it a bit of a twang at the end. Cheers, Bernie. Good olive oil on the bruschetta. This bruschetta's been rubbed with garlic. Lovely jubbly. Theo's gonna finish that now.
It's a new order.
Okay, new order. Two sardines, two linguine, one risotto.
Got a bruschetta.
Is that the concierge? Can you put me through to the concierge?
Four parts for that, mate.
Bass on one. Okay, partridge, two, three, bass. Where's a bass?
There's no night concierge, is there? Dear, dear, dear. Well, the day concierge, Mick, yeah? Yeah, he's booked a table for Priscilla Presley, yeah? At 7:30. This is Limpet at the River Café, by the way. And he booked a table for her for four at 7:30, yeah? And it's now 8:50. I wonder if you could assist me in her whereabouts.
Okay, new order, one squid, one polenta with truffles, one sardines, one risotto, one chanterelle. No garlic on the chanterelle.
Okay. Right, we're going away with the tagliolini now. So that's boiling water, salted, straight in there.
Let's go with the soup. Sardines.
Normally you shake off all the water in the pasta, but as I'm making a very, very basic pasta, because the truffle is going to do all the talking, I'm going to leave quite a lot of water in there and drag it into the bowl.
I've got three on hold.
Three. 42 starting high.
Watch your legs, guys. Got a touch of nutmeg in there. That brings out the flavour in the truffle. And now I'm going to get some parmesan in there. Very rich pasta.
Okay, two pork away.
Two partridge. What?
One of the things about Italy that is very noticeable is that the puddings, the desserts, are not eaten at the end of meals. The most common dessert in Italy is a cup of espresso, very strong espresso.
The puddings we make are strong in flavor and uncomplicated. We're going to show you a really luxurious, festive ice cream made with Vinsanto, an aged Italian wine.
So, this ice cream is made with 20 egg yolks, 400 grams of sugar, and then I'm going to beat it until I have got the mixture to increase in volume by about three times. Now, it's been beating for about 5 minutes, and I've achieved what I'm after, which is a nice, thick, triple volume egg and sugar mixture, which is, you can see how thick it is by me pulling it out with the whisk. And I'm now going to put it in my larger bowl, which is going to go over a saucepan of boiling water. And I'm now basically cooking the eggs. And then I like to stir it, but stir it gently. It's very, very important because you don't want the egg to cook at the bottom of the bowl and not on the sides. As it cooks, it sort of sticks to the bottom of the bowl. And I don't want scrambled egg either, which is what you could get if you had it too hot. I think it's nearly there. It's cooked because the ice cream is now sticking to the spoon and not moving. If it wasn't cooked, it would just fall off the spoon. So I'm now going to leave it to cool, probably about 15 to 20 minutes, depends how cool your kitchen is. Put my cream, my whipped cream, into the cooled egg mixture. Stir it to mix it completely together. It's absolutely perfect. The cream and the eggs have combined, and you can't really tell one from the other. I'm going to put in my Vinsanto, and this is a 500 milliliter bottle of Vinsanto, the best Vinsanto, in my opinion, that you can get in Tuscany. And I'm going to add it in, all of it. We just sort of developed this ice cream by taste, really. We just knew how much to write on the recipe when we got exactly the flavor we were after. Mm. Now, the interesting thing about tasting ice cream before you've churned it is that it may taste too sweet when you taste it in this stage, but when it's frozen, you lose that extra sweetness. And so, you know, there you are, and you hopefully taste the Vinsanto. I don't think there's quite enough, so I'm going to put a bit more in. And it should be the right amount. But I don't know whether it's because it's Christmas, but basically I'm going to put a tiny bit more in. There we go. There's quite a lot of fumes coming up now. Yes. Fabulous. You can taste the Vinsanto. Got the creamy edge to it. What I'm going to do now is that I'm going to put it in our ice cream machine that we use at the restaurant, because I'm going to serve this ice cream to my staff tonight for our party. But you don't need an ice cream machine. You can pour this mixture as it is now into plastic container trays to make ice cream and put it straight in your freezer. The day's over, Ruthie. Let's go and eat and drink.
All right, Rose. Party time, everyone.
Wow, introducing the pig.
Wow, look at this.
For further details on the alternative Christmas menu shown, turn to page 586 of CFAX.
And on Tuesday night at 8:30, Food and Drink features festive recipes on puddings and stuffing. Coming up next on BBC Two, Paula Yates versus Ian Hislop in Have I Got News For You?